ninth lesson, that's our examination as we get into our eighth verse. It's all about what we're called to do. And I really want us to think about tonight, as we've been going through the scriptures, as we've been going through this lesson, what does God want me to do? What is our primary purpose in life? Look at verse 8. Someone read, please.
Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony, nor of me, his prison, but share with me in the
suffering of the Lord. This is a very wonderful scripture. Remember Paul speaking to Timothy, writing to Timothy. This is his last testament. This is his last epistle, a letter that is sent out before he dies at, I believe, at Nero's chopping block. He is sitting in a prison cell, Paul the Apostle, and he's writing, or he has a guard that's writing for him. This letter goes to Timothy, and he's trying to instill everything that he knows. He goes from that, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. And then he says, therefore do not be ashamed. And then he quantifies that of the testimony of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, the question is, what is his testimony? What is God's testimony? What was Jesus' testimony? What was Jesus' testimony? Okay, he was the Son of God. That is a portion of his testimony. What else? The whole, he said, I am the gate. No man can get to the Father but by me. So this whole process here, Jesus was seen as radical. It was blasphemy for the Pharisees that didn't believe that he was the Messiah, because if he wasn't the Messiah, then it was told he should have been burned, he should have been killed, and he was killed. But this whole process, he got up on the third day with all power, so he showed that he was God. So look at this testimony. Paul is speaking to Timothy. This testimony is going to cost you everything. Is going to change your life. And being a follower of Christ wasn't as fashionable as it is today. It's getting worse here, but it's a fashionable thing. We can advertise and mall steal, churches all over the corners, and it's a fashionable thing still in the United States. It's getting worse. Persecution is rising little bit by little bit for those churches who are truly after the Lord. But still now, we can say, I got a Christian, we can wear a cross on our chest, and we've got the little fish on the back of our car. You know, it's kind of a fashion statement. But at this time, to be a follower of the Lord meant that you could potentially die at any time. That your whole life would be changed by just saying, I believe in Christ, and he is my Lord. And it concerns me. I don't want us to ever have to really go in those time settings that Paul the Apostle and Timothy were living in, but I am concerned about how real we are with our faith. Because if we're not challenged with our faith, it's my concern that we really don't know if we have faith. Did that make sense?
Yes.
We can say we have faith all we want to, but if we never had any pressure on our lives to make choices for Jesus and live for him, you really don't know. So look at this process. Don't be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord. It's going to cost you something. He says, nor of who? Timothy, I know some nights that you're sitting in your house and you're going, wow, Paul, the one who writes all this stuff, he's in jail. And God, he's so powerful and mighty, why does he allow Paul, of all people, to be in jail? And you may be ashamed because people are talking about me and they're saying the reason I'm in jail is because, you know what, that gospel he was preaching, that good news, is not powerful enough to deliver him from jail. He's like, don't be ashamed. You got to know, and he explains that second part. He says, but share with me in the sufferings for the what? This is Timothy. This gospel is going to cause you to hurt sometimes. Timothy, this gospel may have you ending your life with me in a prison. But you got to know in whom you believe. That's serious. That is serious, because if someone would come in here tonight, and I'm not prophetic, and they would start putting, guns or shotguns to our head and say, you know what, do you believe in Jesus? If you confess Jesus, I'm going to shoot you right there. If you don't confess him, then you can live. All of us would have to make a choice. Now, some of you are really intelligent. You already start processing that. You're saying, you know what? I would tell them that I did believe, but God knows my heart. See, I got you, did it. You know, God knows my heart, so it'll be all right. I can ask for forgiveness later. You know, I can go on and spread the gospel later. How it does. But I believe that days are coming, and I believe some of us are, on our jobs and our lives. And do we really believe? We challenge you with doing home devotions, praying with your family, and reading the scriptures. And for some of us, that's a tough thing to do. And Paul the Apostle is in jail, sewage running under his feet, but he's still encouraging someone else and telling Timothy, who's on the outside of jail, don't be ashamed of the gospel. Don't be ashamed of me, because it's worth everything according to the power of God. How does the world define the power of God? As you look at the TV airs, maybe the traditional Christians, what is the power of God? What does it do? What's the definition that comes out in your mind? Yeah, the world, or just generally, when we talk about the power of God, what do we think about? We think about healing. What else? The power of God. Okay, parting the Red Sea. Okay, the creation. What else? The power of God. Okay, the pardon of our sins. Somebody else say something?
God is in control.
Okay, God is in control. Anybody else? The world's view, or Christianity mainstream, when we say the power of God. No worries, everything will be wonderful. That's kind of just, trust in the power of God. But the power of God in this, and it concerns me, it scares me sometimes. I'll be honest, I know God has not given us a spirit of fear, but the power of God that he's talking about is in tribulation. That you can have peace when the bottom falls out. We want a cushy life, but that's not necessarily what Jesus promised us. He said, you're going to suffer. You're going to have to go through. And I wonder, if we started out, are we really suffering? And that's the question it gets. Are we really suffering for Christ? Or is our suffering that we're going through self-imposed? Stuff that God already told you not to do, you just went ahead and did it. And now you test, I'm suffering for the Lord. Lord, I can barely make my bills. You the one that guided all that mess. All right, I'm better.
Yeah. I was saying that God is in control. Amen.
The power of God is when you're going through and you should lose it, but God holds you. Some of you have experienced that. When you really, others just couldn't make it. But God, you really sense you're at the end of your rope, you're at the end of your power. You don't have any strength in yourself anymore, and God comes in. Some of you have lost loved ones. I saw Deacon Mevin just in my peripheral vision losing his wife, and he had experienced the power of God through that quick illness that came in and took his wife from him, in a sense. But he knew she was with the Lord, and the power of God had to work. And many of you have dealt with traumatic things in your life where you knew that was nobody but the Lord. And Paul the Apostle is there. Now the question is, what are you suffering because of the gospel? I want you to think about it before you answer this question. If anybody wants to chime in, what are you suffering for because of the gospel? Oh, Wendy just shook her head, so she's out. Yes, Adrian.
Not being able to, I do it anyway. But we're not supposed to talk about Jesus at work.
Okay, all right. So you're suffering, you do share, but that's a suffering because you want to openly share more, but the restrictions say we're not supposed to talk about Christ. Okay. All right. Because the world has put parameters on her faith, in a sense, when she's working on her job. That's suffering. Do you imagine?
Sometimes you have to control that tongue.
Okay. All right.
When you want to lash out at somebody.
As a Christian, you know, we have to believe in what we have been taught, what God is doing, and we want to, you know, put somebody in their place. And that comes up sometimes. And we suffer. Does anybody with me been hurt to hold your tongue? You ever cry? You tears? You cry, oh Lord, I can't take this. But you suffer. That's just a doing.
It's not really something, but you know, we decide rather than, you know, working all the time, trying to make as much as we can, that we're going to help our neighbors, we're going to come to church, we're going to come to church, we're ashamed of the saints. We give up a lot of time to come to church and do the things necessary to, you know, spread the gospel to a certain extent.
He brings out a good one. You choose in your time. Some of you could have made some dollars tonight, right? You could have made some money, got you some more stuff and everything, but there's a suffering process. You're saying, God, I love you so much. I want to make my schedule to the point that I can be here, learn about God's word, share with one another, and it hurts sometimes because your neighbors may have more than you have. They may be doing other things. They got a boat, and you're like, you know, if I could work on Wednesdays, I could get a boat too. And you suffer through these things. Bianca and I and our family have made sacrifices because we saw some stuff in the Word of God and just wouldn't let go of us. And we suffered through. People still think we're strange in some of the things that we do. But the scriptures say we're peculiar people. And we suffer. It hurts. Anybody know it hurts not to be accepted into a crowd or even misunderstood? I want to be understood. I want people to know I love them and everything. But it hurts sometimes to be ostracized, not to accept, to be in conversations with people. And you cannot give your opinions per se because you just don't fit in. You just don't fit in. You're just sitting there and everybody's around you just going, but it's just not clicking. That's suffering. There was somebody else. Yes, Steve.
Last weekend, I had a couple of family members having marriage problems. And it hurt me to know that the reason why, when I found out what was going on, it hurt me because they didn't know that the Word of God, their problem was right. They saw the problem was right in the scripture, and they hadn't been there. And I was able to get two more other family members with me in my home and counsel them. And that's what we didn't know that.
Such a good point, because a lot of things we want to solve quickly. I want you to think, just take a few seconds, think about the stuff that you solved quickly. How did it work out for you? Just think. Some of them may have worked, but the stuff you needed money. So you want to solve that quickly? It worked out for you. You know, or you're trying to get into a house or a car. You had to have a car. Your car just broke down in July for you. There was no other way, public transportation, you weren't going to take that, you had, so you believe God opened up doors, and you went to the place, the John, top car, and you know, no credit report, nothing else, and you quit, you went, hallelujah. How is that working out for you now? That whole process of, as you said, we got to have patience. But that hurts sometimes. When you see other people are quickly, and it looks like everything is going okay in their lives, but you don't know what they lay down with. That's a suffering for the gospel, doing what God has called you. There was a hand.
You know, you were talking about you see a boat, you may want a boat. See, I can consider that boat. Why you have to come to me, why you have to come to my family, to really stand in the scripture.
That's such a good point. God can heal. We know he can, because many of you have been healed. God has put a healing process within our bodies. But the issue is, we're dying. No matter how healthy you are, you're dying. But science doesn't really understand it all. How can we regenerate cells, you know, over and over again? And it would seem like we would continue to get younger, but we continue to get older. So that whole process, we believe God. I've seen God do so much. He was this preacher. He was in a faith movie. He said, I believe in God that my hair never turns gray. Of course, he was about 32 when he said that. And he said, I believe in God. He said, my hair, and that was his confession of faith, my hair will never turn gray. You know what? After about 10 years, he just is grayer than me. He is. And he was dying and all of that, and people started to realize, you know, that black is blacker than black. That's a shame. But, I mean, some things, come on. We have to have a reality. God did not create us here, at least in this time period, to stay. The only way we're going to have everlasting life is to be with him, or he come back and change us from these bodies that are corruptible. Look at that next verse. Someone read, please. Now this is key. Some of you want to know your callings and what is the Lord doing. Paul writes to Timothy. He has a church. He's a pastor, a senior pastor in a sense, ministering to them. He says, but don't be ashamed of the gospel. Know whom you have believed is the power of God who has saved us. Saved us. What does saved mean? What does saved mean? Okay, that's sanctification. What does saved mean? Delivered, and that's a good one. We can use that. You were dying. You couldn't fix yourself, but God delivered you or saved you. And I think some of us, me, I've not had that encounter, to know I was dying. I was dead. But God, in his grace and mercy, reached down and saved me. And this is the whole portion of that testimony. Who has saved us and called us with the what? Every one of you hopefully has been saved. And if you've been saved, you've been saved and God has given you a holy call. So you can tell all your friends and everything, I have a calling on my life. Of course, the first thing they're going to think, oh, you're supposed to minister in the pulpit and everything. No, I'm saved. I got a calling in my life because God saved me for a purpose. And maybe that purpose is just living to glorify him, because your life, people look at your life more than what you say. They really do. People look at you. You may think that nobody's looking at you. They are looking at you. And you are infecting people for the Lord, or you're infecting them for the devil. And as you think about the day, have you caused people to go closer to the Lord? Or are they like thinking about you going, I hate that person. And they mad at their family, kicking their dog because of what you did in their life. Are you infecting them for the good news or against God? Who has called us for the holy calling, not according to what? This is key. This is the gospel. It's by grace that we're saved, not of ourselves. It's the gift of God. You can't work your way to heaven. Deacon Kelly said this in Sunday school. What you have to understand, I work because I am saved. All right, you can't do enough works to get in heaven. You can't be the best goody two shoes and say, you know what, Lord, you gotta take me in because I did better than Deacon Kelly, or you know, I was a better church member than Brother Wednesday, so I gotta get in. No, it just doesn't work that way. It's not by your works, because there are a lot of folks that do better than us. The Muslims do better than us. Right, the Muslims, they do. They're willing to die for terrorists. They're willing to die for their faith. They're willing to bomb up folks and everything like that. They're really people that aren't, and I'm not picking on them. They sell bean pies in the sunshine with a three-piece suit on. I'm telling you, them boys got some focus. No, this whole process here, but you can't get in by works. You can't work your way enough to get in, but we're saved by his grace, who's given us a holy calling. Not according to our works. I work because I have been saved. I work because I have been changed. I'm not working to be saved. That third part, but according to who? His own purpose. Whose own purpose? Now, we've been taught, especially for you, you've been brought up in America, we've been taught to have our own purpose. What you going to do when you grow up? How often do we say, what has God called you to do when you grow up? He's all, what are you, and we got colleges. You know, let us set your career. This is the best career for you. Let us train you. How does that work out for us? How many of you done switched degrees over and over again and you still don't know what you're called to do? How many was supposed to be in college 4 years and it ended up being 8 years and now you're broke, busted, and disgusted and need to go back for another 4? How is that working out for you? All of these processes that we try, but if we're saved, it's according to His own purpose. So we got to find out what He wants for our life. And that's a tough one. Because what if He wants you to die in a jail? All by yourself. What if He wants you to suffer your entire life? Or a portion of your life? Ask Job about that. How that's going to work out for you. Are you going to say, you know, I'm off His plan? There are people that are born seriously handicapped. And they suffer through their life. They are in constant pain, hurting, all of their lives, but they still love the Lord. How would you fare in that situation? According to His purpose, His own purpose, and grace, grace enables you to do God's will. This is the key. This is the definition for you. Grace enables you to do God's will. Without grace, you can't do His will. You can't. Without grace, I can't do what I'm doing at Ebenezer. I just can't. Now, I'll be doing it in my own spirit and everything, but it's not going to be effective. It's not going to have lasting results. It's just going to be a show. But with grace, He enables me to do something that I can't do within myself. He enables you to do things that you can't do within yourself. I'm blessed, and the ladies have been very open with their lives. They come from broken families, but forgiveness has been wrought in those families. When you can come to church with someone you fell out with and broke up and eat dinner with them and still love them, you got some grace going on. You got some grace. Some people who have hurt you deeply, but you can go and embrace them. That's grace. That's the only way you can truly do God's will. Look at this. And grace which was given to us, where? All comes Christ. Uses Christ. Christ definition. What does that mean? In the Greek, some of y'all, what does Christ mean? The anointed, okay? The anointed. We talk about the anointing, falling sin. The anointing comes from Christ. It's in Christ, the anointed one, Jesus, before time began. Now, this is great. We're going to go in that commentary. God knew that you were going to get saved. You haven't been saved. He knows when you're going to get saved. And He already had a plan and purpose that you needed to walk in before you ever even thought about it. Everything, all the bad stuff that you've done in your life, God knew it was going to happen. And God already worked it in His plan. Now, that's awesome. Now, we're not going to get into predestination because that's what it is. But because God knows everything, He is not limited by our mess-ups. There ought to be a few amens in the house. Because God knows everything. He knows how, and I use this line, He knows how jacked up you are. He knew all of the mistakes you were going to make, and He was sad. It hurt His heart, but He said, you know what? I got it worked out. The devil's like, you know, I'm going to take them out. They're going to hell. And God's like, no, you can only do as much as I allow you to do. It's already worked out. It's going to be a long journey. It's going to be a lot of hurt. It's going to be a lot of tediousness within their lives. But when it all said and done, when they stand before you, for me, I'm going to say, well done. I tell you, that's good news. Someone read that commentary, please.
Salvation and service are all by grace, not a human power. Us, Paul put Timothy's calling on the same par with his own. This must have added courage to Timothy before the world began. How humble and awesome the responsibility.
All of us have a responsibility to do what God has called you to do. All of you. You may think my primary responsibility is to be Pastor Ebenezer. Wrong. You know what my primary responsibility is? The pastor of my home. I love y'all, but the scriptures are very clear, and we went through that. You know, if I teach y'all, and y'all do good, but my house is falling apart, I'm a hypocrite. The scriptures are very clear. How can I leave Ebenezer if I'm not trying to leave my home? So we get it out. We think being in public ministry is all of that. No, your primary calling is to your own home, your own self with the Lord, revelation and walking with Him and whatever He's called you to do. And so many people miss that and this great responsibility. We got an awesome responsibility because I have to answer for your soul here, but I got to answer for my family. I got to answer for all the time that I'm outside of Ebenezer. And guess what? All those hours that you spend doing whatever you do, 150 chapters, all those hours, you got to give it a count for them. You just thought God was just going to tally up this Sunday, huh? Or you're Wednesday. It don't work that way. You are what you are when you're by yourself. Not when you're in front of us, because we know how to put up. We got dressed. I smell deodorant and perfume. You clean this up real good. We put up our best front in front of people. But what you really are is when nobody's looking. So that's your ministry, right? When nobody's looking, how are you? That's what you're going to be accounted when you stand before God. That's what He's going to look. All this other stuff is kind of fluff. It's kind of icing on the cake. But what we are comes at when we're in our home. We're sitting there at the computer. We go to this website and that website, or we're texting, and we're talking back and forth, or we're walking, or somebody cuts us off while we're driving. And you were in the right. But let's see what kind of minister are you being? All right, I'm messing again. Someone read verse 10, please. Immortality. We got to make sure we get that word correct. It's a powerful. Read that first commentary, please. That first paragraph. This is the crux of our faith. And I'm telling you, it's real. If you don't believe it, it is real. Jesus actually lived. History will tell you that. You can ask a Muslim. Muslims believe that Jesus actually lived. They don't believe He's the Messiah, but they believe. History will tell you. All these accounts and everything, there was a Jesus Christ that lived. Now, the issue is, was He God? That's the whole part. But He lived. He taught. He did these things. This is a actuality. This is a reality of our faith. And once you get that, okay, He actually lived. Now you got to say, is He Lord? But He's been revealed. He walked. God came from heaven to earth to walk amongst us. That's awesome. So now we've got to deal with that revelation, that knowledge. He was revealed. What you going to do with it? If God took the time to come and walk upon the earth, so we could be delivered and set free, how are you going to take that revelation? How are you going to live your life? So this whole process of being revealed by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, it's not within this scripture, but because He's appeared once, He's going to appear again. He's coming back. And what are you going to say when you stand before Him? I'm going to be on my face. But what are you going to say before Him? When you see Him face to face, and He's going to shock y'all because He's not going to be, you know, what you think He's going to be. He really ain't. He ain't going to be like none of the pictures you ever seen, but you're going to know it's Him. You're going to go, oh my goodness. But you're going to have to see Him face to face one day. Look at this next paragraph. Someone read, please. You can go ahead and finish.
Thank you.
I mean, you put a big mark around that, because it's tough. We talk real good, and I can teach this thing real good, but when you're dealing with death, when I heard about Brother Sam Jeffers, it's tough. It's tough to, because he said he abolished death, but people are still dying. Our loved ones are dying. We're looking in the mirror, and we're dying. You abolished death. Well, this is just temporary. This thing right here, but he annulled it. He took the sting after this death, because to be absent from the body means that I'm present with the Lord. So only have to suffer a little bit if the Lord chooses us to suffer in that respect. But once this body stops, man, that is eternal life. And this whole process for a Christian, this is good news. I love that last comment. It says, it is our servant rather than our master. It's a tough one, and I guess as we get older, we get, but to know that that's my way out. If the Lord doesn't come back, the only way we're going to get, and I said this earlier, the only way you're going to get to see Jesus, listen to it, is to die. That is that stepping stone to get to him. And some of us now, especially if we're young, we have fear of that. And we may not want to admit it, but we don't like to talk about death. We really don't. We want to stay healthy. And in our minds, the devil kind of hoodwinks us. You're going to live to be 100 and whatever. You don't even want to say the last number because you figure that you're kind of closing off your days. You already know. You like Michael Jackson. You already got your little thing and you're going to freeze your body and you're just going to live on. Okay, try it. See how that works out for you. All of us, if the Lord tarries, are going to have to take our last breath. And you can either fear it, or you can embrace it and say, hallelujah. Whenever that comes, I'm stepping over. Death is not going to be tyrant, but death is just a door to step in to be with Jesus. Isn't that a beautiful way to look at that? And I think we, as Christians, we have to embrace it like that. Be careful. That changes everything. If you really believe, it changes everything. If you don't believe, I'm telling you, true atheists, if they really believe, I mean, you would just be off the chain. You'd do anything. Because you have no moral standards of any type. Because you don't believe in any moral standards. If you don't believe in God, you don't believe that there's a moral standard. You just kind of do what you want to do, whenever you want to do it. And you can try to say, unless it doesn't hurt anybody, but just think all the stuff that you would do if you didn't believe or didn't have any standards. Look at that next paragraph. Go ahead, please. He's shown us because he was resurrected. He says, I go to prepare a place for you. We know we're going to be with him. That's so comforting. That after this life is said and done, he has a better life that's prepared for us. Who wants to go tonight? Oh, I got a real car. I just thought of it. Sorry, I just wanted to see if you're listening. But he has. He is prepared for us. A wonderful. Y'all got scared. Oh, Lord. But the reality is he has a wonderful place, so we live our life to the fullest here according to his will and know that there is a better place that's prepared for us. Look at that end part of that. He has brought life and immortality to life through the gospel. A heavenly hope set before them, yet for the most part they did not understand it clearly. And I believe even in the New Testament, a lot of Christians don't understand that. Because we would live differently, as Deacon Kelly said. If you're a true Christian, you have an understanding that there is a better place There is accountability for what we live in this life, and God has left us here for a specific purpose, not to keep everything upon ourselves. And some of us are living to the fullest for ourselves. When I say living a full life for Christ, I want all my time to be for the Lord. Does that mean that we don't mess up? Does that mean we don't have time that we get caught up? No. But it means a majority of my time is going to be on Jesus. I've learned to repent quickly and say, God, help me. Help me. Order my steps to get me where I need to be. Go ahead with that next paragraph. And. Oh, you just shout. That's good. Next paragraph. That's good, because I've had the experience, and many of you, in that lifeless body. And it drives you crazy. I was over there, Sam was there on my mind, and I saw them take his body out. But you know what? I knew that was his body. He was no longer there. He was no longer there. And you have to have that reality, even as this commentary brings out. He is absent from the body and home with the Lord. He enters into eternal life in all its fullness. That's beautiful. But it's tough because we miss the physical side of a person. That flesh and blood of them being around us. But if you believe, guess what? You'll get to see them again. We don't know how long, but you'll get to see them again. And we'll be with them for an eternity. And that is good news. That's the reality and the teachings that Christians must have. And also Paul is bringing back to Timothy, encouraging him. And Timothy has been in the faith. He's walking in the faith. But we need these realities brought before us to remind us, because the enemy can beat us. He can beat us so much, and sometimes we can slip into this mode that this life is everything. You ever felt that? You don't have to raise your hand, but you just feel like, you know, if I don't make it in this life, if I don't please such and such, if I don't do this, if I don't drive this type of car, I just have failed. Look at that. This life is just a training area. What real life is the life to come. Deacon Man.
And Pastor, what you were saying there, I had to deal with my little granddaughters about that when their grandmother passed. And they said, this don't look like this. God explained to them that that's not her.
Amen.
She's gone to God. That's just a body that she was using. No, that's not her anymore. Then they accept it.
That's a good point. I like it when bodies are put in the church or whatever, they don't look like the person. You know, some of you are like, oh my goodness. I do, because it reminds me. That's not them. That's not them. And I know you wanted to look just like mama or whoever and everything like that. And sometimes they do an excellent job that, you know, they can just start breathing anytime. That messes with your mind here. But, you know, that messes with your mind. It really does. You know, but when you reach over, you touch that body and it's cold. I mean, that kind of, you know, is that mom or is that such and such? No, that's not. That's their body. That's the shell that was left. But that's not them. All of us know. We talk about the fear of snakes. If you see a snake skin that's there, do you think that's the snake when you look at the skin? I'm still running from the skin. Those that have overcome that fear. When we look at the snake skin, we don't have fear. We know it's just the skin. All right? In this whole process of being a Christian, we know this is just the skin that we're going to shed. The tabernacle talks about it. The tent that we're going to shed one day. Get ready for it. I love that old song. This old building keeps on leaning. I got to move. Better home. Maybe your building ain't leaning yet, but it will. Next verse. Somewhere please.
Christ not only brought life to life, but also the mortality. The mortality refers to the resurrection of the body. When we read in 1 Corinthians 15:3 that this corruptible must put on incorruption, we know that even though the body is placed in the grave, yet at the coming of Christ, that same body will be raised from the grave and fashioned into a body of glory.
lot of teaching on just this whole process, which is good. Go ahead and pinch yourself a little bit, just to, and tell yourself, this is corruptible. Now, the definition, what does corruptible mean? Is what? It will not last. It's going to go to some. It doesn't last. And then we have a reality of it. It doesn't last. And all of the lay and all of the other things, they made millions and billions of dollars. We got plastic surgeons that are tucking and pulling and poking and putting stuff in, Botoxing and all of that to try to make us believe that this stuff lasts. It just doesn't. Now, some of you are blessed. Some of you got good genes, and you'll be 80, and you'll still look fresh and vibrant. But we'll just look at your ankles, and your ankles will tell us that. There's something on your body that you may hide or keep it tells you. Every time you look at you, whoo, I'm getting old. There's something. So everybody got something. And you go, whoo, that's getting old. We're going to keep that under wraps. God is very good at that. He gives us something. For those who don't do our hair tells us. We're getting older. You know, comedian, I was looking at something the other day, and he said, as men, we our hair drops out, and we go, why'd you give up so easy? You know, we might not get that one back, and that might not grow. And that we all know that this stuff is passing away, and we try to do whatever we can do. And I want you to keep yourself healthy and in shape and all that, but you're going to be in the gym, and you're going to be the picture perfect, and you're going to pull something. Yeah. And you know what? It's probably not even going to happen in the gym. You're going to have a good workout, and you're just going to be in the house. You're just going to be walking to the refrigerator, and your hamstring going to go, ooh! And you're like, what happened? It's corruptible. It's passing away. And you're going to ask yourself, you're going to have this conversation, why? I kept myself up, and I've been taking my vitamins and drinking my water. Why? And God's going to say, I told you it was corruptible. I told you it was going to pass away. It is. It is right now. There was some hair. Yes.
Pastor, I see in both these paragraphs, one is saying that, you know, when a believer dies, he goes to be with Jesus. And then the other one, you say that when coming to Christ, we get new bodies. Mm-hmm. And then when you go in with Christ, talking about from the rich man and Lazarus, well, the rich man, he saw Abraham and everyone across the great chasm in heaven. And so the thing of it is, and probably it was the great unknown when we read the Bible, is that when someone dies in Christ, do they immediately go to heaven? And then if they come to Christ, then we go to judgment.
Right.
But in some circumstances, like the parable of Jesus, it seems like there's already a judgment, because the rich man went to hell, he was already condemned before.
Right. And remember our teaching on that. I'm going to take you back. I'm going to go in a little bit of cosmology. Not cosmetology, but the cosmos. So I'm going to deal with your mind at this point. We live inside of time. Right? We do. If we're looking at time, it'll be over, and we'll go on to our next point. 24 hours, whether you like it or not, it just keeps on clicking. Sometimes we have leap years, but time. We are quantified by time. But remember, our teaching, God is on the outside of time. All right? So when we look at this, to be absent from the body means to be present with God, yes. It does. When we look at the rich man and Lazarus and all that, we have to look at it from our perspective. That whole story is from our perspective, looking in a time point. But God is outside of time. So God can literally, let's say he wanted to, judgment is not until 1,000 years. Still to die means to be with the Lord. Because we don't even sense that time, because he's outside of time. He controls time. And to say that, we're talking out to both sides, that there actually is time. But this is the key. Now listen to this. This is going to mess with your mind. There is no time in God. He's infinite. There's no time with God. God created time. But when we die, we enter where? outside of time. And that's one of those things, those quantum leap things. God holds time just like this. He can move time right here. He can move time right here. Ask Joshua. Joshua said, you know, Lord, we're fighting. Since you're in control of time, we don't have enough time by the time that you put it to beat the enemy. Can you do me a favor? Can you hold the sun? Can you do that for me? Now, that's the basic thing. I don't even know why I got here, but because he's outside. God, since you're outside of time, can you just hold the creation? Can you just put everything? And we already know scientifically that, you know, moon, stars, all the other planets, everything is connected. You know, all the cosmos, the ones we know and we don't know, everything's connected. So what Joshua was saying, God, just hold everything. Just hold. Just keep it right there. While, now, I need you to freeze it, but don't freeze up. See, I'll preach about that sometime. I want you to freeze the sun, but let us keep on fighting. Let us somehow be in time, and we're still aging, so I need you to do a double time thing. Hold the sun, let our time keep running, and when you feel fit, when we finish, can you start it back up? God did it, right? Last example, Lazarus. How long was he dead? 4 days. Jesus was not rushed, because he already knew our whole time. Time is what they dealing with. And he said, you know what, I'm glad I didn't rush. He did. He said, I'm glad, because it was going to take you a little time to even understand that I'm outside of time. God and Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. You know, he started out, I am the resurrection. Okay, I know that, but Martha, no, you don't. I got it. It doesn't matter how long but he's thinking. Why? She's looking from her perspective. These 4 days he's been decomposing and everything going on, and God is laughing like, so what? So what? I can jump start it whenever I want to jump start it. So it's a hard concept, but just remember, God is outside of time. And theologically, we can teach on different perspectives if there's a period of time between there, but it comes back to this point, God controls time. He can do whatever he wants with it.
But even in death, though, we're in the image of God, because when you're dead, you're outside of time anyway. I mean, you're in eternity.
Your spirit is, yes. And that's why our flesh can't cross over. This flesh, this corruptible, isn't that where we're at? This corruptible must put on immortality. So that whole process, we have to have a glorified body, which Jesus showed us. A body, and I love this. I'm looking forward to it. I don't want to die tonight. But I'm looking forward to a body that can literally go through walls. We see it, and it's not a ghost. He's outside of time, so those material things, remember, how did I get to here? The scriptures are specific. The things we see come from those things that we don't see. So if everything that we see comes out of the things we don't see, then it means the don't see stuff is greater than the stuff we see. That's why he could walk through the stuff we see. Did that come out right? All right, I'm starting to get overloaded here. All right, you good?
I'm good.
All right. I can go deeper if you want. All right, the next verse, please. Read it, please. Now, this is awesome. We've gone through all of that, talking about death and God taking the sting out of death and what life is all about, and everybody has a calling. And then he gets to the point, I was appointed a preacher. What does preacher mean? Proclaim. That's what it means. A proclaimer of the gospel. Which is ironic because he's actually sitting in jail. Okay? But still, your calling is not affected by your circumstances. That's another thing. Really, your calling is not affected by your circumstances because it's all according to faith. You're believing in God to do whatever God wants to do. So it doesn't matter. Your circumstances will never stop God. If you're in God's will, your circumstances never stop the will of God. And that's encouraging to me. So I was called appointed, and I don't want to miss that, appointed a preacher and an apostle. What does an apostle mean? One who is sent out. Now this is key, at least in this translation, apostle nor preacher is capitalized. Right? In essence, we all are sent out ones. We all are proclaimers. Look at this. And a teacher And he has a specific calling of the who? Gentiles or the heathens. He was a Pharisee of a Pharisee, but God did not choose him to teach those that he grew up as. He taught them. He put him at the point of teaching people who were unlike him. And that's interesting. That God actually chose Paul the Apostle. I thought he would be a great teacher. And he did teach to the Jews from time to time, but that was not his primary calling. It was to teach folks who were unlike him. That way, he would not be dependent in his power, but he would be dependent in the power of God. Does that make sense? Because he would have been good. He knew the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all of these things, and he could have winged it in himself. But when you have to teach people that you're not used to, and they're coming from different ways, then you really have to depend on the power of God. Someone read that commentary, please. Paul the Apostle, on the level that we're dealing with this, he was called, but all of us have these functions in our lives. You're indoctrinating somebody. You've been a parent, you indoctrinate someone. You're putting some life skill in somebody that will affect them for the rest of their life. All of us have. We've indoctrinated some people. And a lot of times I ain't indoctrinated. Yes, you are. You are indoctrinating. You are pouring in, and that's that whole process of teaching. Look at this final thing tonight. We're going to close out. We're going to kind of step into an example of courage. Once you know who you are, once you know whose you are, and once you know what you are. So who you are, whose you are, and what you are, it changes everything. Because what I am, I'm corruptible. This flesh is going to pass away anyway. So I don't fear man going to take it away. I don't fear that because I'm an everlasting being in the spirit. And God's going to give me a new body anyway. And I know whose I am. I'm no longer my own. I'm not the captain of my ship. I don't control my destiny. Did you know that? You really don't. You don't control your destiny by any means, shape, or form. Because if you controlled your destiny, many of you would not be here at Ebenezer Baptist Church tonight. Right? You'd be somewhere else and wherever. But you don't control that, God. So who you are, whose you are, what was the final one? What you are. Once you got that nailed, the example of courage, people began to look at your life. This final verse of the night, someone read verse 12, please.
This reason I also spoke of these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day.
And it's awesome. Amen. All of this stuff, this knowledge of death and resurrection and life and Jesus and him saving us and not of our works that any man should boast, but it's all about him. For this reason, I also live the good life. Oh, we didn't say that. That I suffer. Because I know that this life is not the end, I'm willing to suffer in this life. I'm willing to hurt. I'm willing to be subjected to hurt and heartache because I know this is not the end. Now, that's awesome. I'm willing to go all out for the Lord. For this reason, I also suffer these things, specifically, he's in a jail, all because of God. It is the reason that Paul sits in that Tullian key with sewage under his feet and by himself cold is because of God. He chose to lay it all on the line. He chose to go all out for the Lord and look where it ended him up. And if anybody should have a palace or nice, you know, neighborhood, gated, good chariot, you know, gold wheels and stuff like that. Should have been Paul. I mean, come on, God. You don't let the guy who writes 3/4 of the New Testament caught up into the third heavens outside of time and saw things that he couldn't even communicate back. Just end like this. Yes, sometimes you do. So that whole process, for this reason, I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am what?
Not ashamed.
because I know who I am. I know my call. I'm not ashamed. I hurt. I cry. But I'm not ashamed because I know in whom I believe. Yes, sir. Amen. Amen. We must suffer many things to follow Christ.
Even though he was locked up, he was still preaching. He was on
yes.
the outside. And when the wall showed, he loved because he had a part of something.
How awesome it must have been to be in such a powerhouse, not in himself, but Christ in him. In that weakness, he said, I learned that when I'm weak, then I'm strong. And when you're sitting in chains, God must have just been jumping off of him. I mean, obviously, he's writing letters and everything, and the prisoners, and he said he had his own personal guard at one time, at least before this. I mean, people literally, guards were getting saved around him. He was just so powerful, he would just share. He would just be himself, and the anointing would just kind of flow out. I mean, that's awesome. Just an example of what must have been like to be around Jesus at that time. Look at this final thing. It says, for I know whom I believe, am what? I just want to leave you on this last part tonight. I'm persuaded. What are you persuaded of? It says that he is what? Maybe next time we'll come back and talk a little bit more about that. But I want you to think, this is your homework, what have you committed to? I really want you to think about it. Like, what gave my life to Jesus? What have you committed to the Lord? Because if you committed something to him, you've given it to him. What have you literally given in your life to the Lord and said, God, you got to control this. Because I cannot control this. I tried. It didn't work out. Here, I give it to you. What have you committed to him? And what do you know he's able to keep? So on next time, that's your homework, we're going to really look at that and examine that more. What have you committed to the Lord? What are you persuaded of? Amen? Did I get all of them? Yes. Amen. Amen. We're good at starting a commitment. But sometimes we're better at taking a commitment back. And then we have to ask the question, were we really ever committed? All right, come on, let's go home.